Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Looking for Alibrandi, written by Melina Marchetta and read by Marcella Russo. This book begins with a dedication. To Mummy and Daddy, Marissa and Daniela, life is good because of you. Also for my grandparents, Salvatore, Carmela and Maria. In memory of Giovanni Marchetta, 1910 to 1991. Nonno, when are we ever going to stop missing you? Chapter 1. Panic was my first reaction to the multiple choice options which lay on my desk in front of me. I glanced at the students around me before turning back to question 3. I hated multiple choice. Yet I didn't want to get question 3 wrong. I didn't want to get any of them wrong. The outcome would be too devastating for my sense of being. So I began with elimination. D was completely out of the question, as was A. So that left B and C. I pondered both for quite a while. And just as I was about to make my final decision, I heard my name being called. Josephine? Huh? I think you mean I beg your pardon, don't you, dear?
I beg your pardon, sister?
What are you doing?
You're reading, aren't you, young lady?
Yeah.
Excellent, Josephine. I can see you walking away with the English prize this year. Now stand up.
So, my final school year began. I had promised myself that I would be a saint for this year alone. I would make the greatest impression on my teachers and become the model student. I knew it would all fail, but just not on the first day. Sister Gregory walked towards me, and when she was so close that I could see her moustache, she held out her hand.
Show me what you're reading.
I handed it to her and watched her mouth purse itself together and her nostrils flare in triumph because she knew she was going to get me. She skimmed it and then handed it back to me. I could feel my heart beating fast.
Read from where you're up to.
I picked up the magazine and cleared my throat. What kind of friend are you? I read from Hot Pants magazine. She looked at me pointedly. You're at a party, I began with a sigh. And your best friend's good-looking, wealthy, and successful boyfriend tries to make a pass. Do you, A, smile obligingly and steal away into the night via the back door? B, throw your cocktail all over his country road suit? C, quietly explain the loyalty you have towards your friend? D, tell your friend instantly, knowing that she will make a scene? You can understand now why I found it hard to pick between B and C.
May I ask what this magazine has to do with my religion class, miss?
Religion?
Yes, dear,
she continued in her sickeningly sarcastic tone.
The one we are in now.
Well, quite a lot, sister. I heard snickers around me as I tried to make up as much as I could along the way. Religion class, first period, Monday morning, is the place to try to pull the wool over the eyes of Sister Gregory. She kept her male saint's name, although the custom went out years ago. She probably thinks it will get her into heaven. I don't think she realizes that feminism has hit religion, and that the female saints in heaven are probably also in revolt.
Would you like to explain yourself, Josephine?
I looked around the classroom, watching everyone shrugging almost sympathetically. They thought I was beaten. We were talking about the Bible, right?
I personally think that you don't know what we've been talking about, Josephine. I think you're trying to fool me.
The nostrils flared again. Sister Gregory is famous for nostril flaring. Once I commented to someone that she must have been a horse in another life. She overheard and scolded me, saying that, as a Catholic, I shouldn't believe in reincarnation.
Fool you, sister. Oh, no, it's just that while you were speaking, I remembered the magazine. You were talking about today's influences that affect our Christian lives, right?
Anna, one of my best friends, turned to face me and nodded slightly.
And?
Well, sister, this magazine is a common example, I said, picking it up and showing everyone. It's full of rubbish. It's full of questionnaires that insult our intelligence. Do you think they have articles titled, Are You a Good Christian? Or Do You Love Your Neighbour? No. They have articles titled, Do You Love Your Sex Life? Knowing quite well that the average age of the reader is 14. Or does size count? And let me assure you, sister, they are not referring to his height.
I brought this magazine in today, sister, to speak to everyone about how insulted we are as teenagers and how important it is that we think for ourselves and not through magazines that exploit us under the guise of educating us.
Sarah, another friend of mine, poked her fingers down her mouth as if she was going to vomit. Sister and I stared at each other for a long time before she held out her hand again. I passed the magazine to her, knowing she hadn't been fooled.
You can pick it up from Sister Louise, she said, referring to the principal.
The bell rang and I packed my books quickly, wanting to escape her icy look.
You are full of it, Sarah said as we walked out. And you owe me a magazine. I threw my books into my locker and ignored everyone's sarcasm.
Well, what was it?
Lee grinned.
A, B, C or D?
I would have gone with him, Sarah said, spraying half a can of hairspray around her gelled hair.
Sarah, if they jailed people for ruining the ozone layer, you'd get life, I told her, turning back to Lee.
I was going to go for the cocktail on the country road suit. The second bell for our next class rang, and with a sigh I made another pledge to myself that I would be a saint. On the whole, I make plenty of pledges that I don't keep. My name, by the way, is Josephine Alibrandi, and I turned 17 a few months ago, the 17 that Janice Ian sang about where one learns the truth. I'm in my last year of high school at St. Martha's, which is situated in the eastern suburbs, and next year I plan to study law. For the last 5 years, we have been geared for this year, the year of the HSC, the higher school certificate, where one's whole future can skyrocket or go through the toilet, or so they tell us. Personally, I feel that the HSC is the least of my problems. Believe me, I could write a book about problems. Yet my mother says that as long as we have a roof over our head, we have nothing to worry about. Her naivety really scares me. We live in Glebe, a suburb just outside the city centre of Sydney and 10 minutes away from the harbour. Glebe has two facades. One is of beautiful tree-lined streets with gorgeous old homes, and the other, which is supposed to be trendy, has old terraces with views of outhouses and clotheslines. I belong to the latter. Our house is an old terrace. We, my mother Christina and I, live on the top. We were actually renting the place till I was 12, but the owner sold it to us for a great price. And although I've calculated that Mama will have it paid off when I'm 32, it's good not to be renting in these days of housing problems. My mother and I have a pretty good relationship, if a bit erratic. One minute, we love each other to bits and spend hours in deep and meaningful conversation. And next minute, we'll be screeching at each other about the most ridiculous thing, from my room being in a state of chaos to the fact that she won't let me stay overnight at a friend's home. She works as a secretary and a translator for a few doctors in Leichhardt, a suburb unfortunately close to my grandmother's home, which means I have to go straight to Nonna's in the afternoon and wait for her. That really gets on my nerves. Firstly, the best-looking guys in the world take the bus to Glebe, while the worst take the bus to where my grandmother lives. Secondly, if I go straight home in the afternoon, I can play music full volume, whereas if I go to Nonna's, the only music she has is Mario Lanza's greatest hits. My mother is pretty strict with me. My grandmother tries to put her 2 cents worth in as well, but Mama hates her butting in. The two of them are forever at loggerheads with each other. Like, whenever school camp comes along, it's fights galore. My grandmother thinks that if a member of our family isn't looking after me, I'll get raped or murdered. She accuses my mother of being a bad mother for not caring enough and letting me go. Mama almost gives in to her each time, and some days, when the three of us are together, it's World War III. So, not being able to go out a lot is one of my many problems. My biggest, though, is being stuck at a school dominated by rich people. Rich parents, rich grandparents, mostly Anglo-Saxon Australians, who I can't see having a problem in the world. Then, there are the rich Europeans. They're the ones who haven't had a holiday for 20 years just so their children can go to expensive schools and get the proper education which they missed out on. These people might have money, but they're grocers or builders, mainly labourers. However, they were smart. They moved out of the inner west and inner city and became respectable. Being respectable has made them acceptable. I come under the scholarship category. And when I say that, I would rather be the daughter of a labourer. I felt disadvantaged from the beginning, maybe because I hadn't gone to the same primary school as them, or maybe because I received the 6-year English scholarship. I don't know why I tried so hard to win it, but it backfired on me because I ended up going to a school I didn't like. I wanted to go to a school in the inner west where all my friends had gone. They were Italian and Greek, and we ruled primary school. They were on my level. I related to them. They knew what it meant not to be allowed to do something. They knew what it meant to have a grandmother dressed in black for 40 years. I looked like them. Dark hair, dark eyes, olive skin. We sounded alike as well. It felt good being with other confused beings. We were all caught up in the middle of two societies. I think I had it worst. My mother was born here, so as far as the Italians were concerned, we weren't completely one of them. Yet, because my grandparents were born in Italy, we weren't completely Australian. Despite that, primary school was the only time I was with people I could compare notes with and find a comfortable place alongside. We'd slip our Italian and Greek into our English and swap salami and prosciutto sandwiches at lunchtime, and life was good in the schoolyard. Life outside school, though, was a different story. The reaction of the Italian mothers to my mother being unmarried drove me crazy at times. There is nothing terribly romantic about my mother's supposed fall from grace. She slept with the boy next door when they were 16, and before anything could be decided, his family moved to Adelaide. Although he knew she was pregnant, he never bothered to contact her again. We do know that he's alive and is a barrister in Adelaide, but that's about it. I don't know where the logic is, but back then, no one was allowed to come and stay at my house. I knew they wanted to, yet I never understood why they couldn't. God knows what their parents thought my mother would do or say to their children. I think things got worse when I started at St. Martha's, because I began to understand what the absence of a father meant. Also, there were no Europeans like me. No Europeans who didn't have money to back them up. The ones like me didn't belong in the eastern and northern suburbs. I used to hear my illegitimacy mentioned during the first years at St. Martha's, but nobody has spoken about it for ages. Still, I wish someone else at school had a bohemian mother who believed in free love back then. It's an embarrassing contradiction when your mother gets pregnant out of wedlock because her Catholic upbringing prohibits contraception. Even though the girls at St. Martha's don't mention it, I bet you they're talking about me behind my back. I can feel it in my bones. It makes me feel I will never be part of their society, and I hate that because I'm just as smart as they are. Anyway, the other day after the magazine incident, I couldn't wait to get out of St. Martha's. When I went to see Sister Louise, she handed me back the magazine and asked me to write a 2,000-word conversation between myself and the editor of Hot Pants magazine. I took the bus straight home instead of going to see my grandmother, deciding that I'd use the HSC as an excuse not to see her for most of this year. I was relieved to be going home because it was so hot. The temperature must have been in the high.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.